Shinji lab jira shazo zongara bama sarda Ordinaya jina shantan bama gesara dhombo Yamzam choko ngudhuni bama amchongde jisa Dangkordam kandu mambu kuru chichi jisa dhaju Shinji lab jira shazo zongara bama sarda Oma hong banzirangara bama sarda Oma hong banzirangara bama Sardo ma hum 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 banzirangara bama sardo kela da jang sora de be da so ganda de be sab jo san da wa bon da jo jwa Chudan Trajin Piram Zata Sur Chumdun Dim Gumbo Jang Horayang La Shang Zar Lo Gunga Lo Chu Chum Ni Chachar Nya Tang Nam Tara Sar Shin Nye Tung Gung Chim Shin Su Shir Ni Ji Takara La Wam Zang Kang Ta Tri Bi Zong Ra Ma Ra Gung Man Tung Ding Gura Chi Sar Vin Ra So Kang La Va Chi Tar Si Yan La Chu Chi Yang Tung Song Tuk Tri Chi Chung Nyo Mo Nyo Lo Li Chi Chao Chu Chum Za Chang Ma Ra Gung Man Sar Ding Gura Mi Ga Chu Nyo Chum Za Ra Tan Do Ne Da Chang Sab Chim Ta Song Yung Tung Li Zo Ya Chi Ta Wu Ga Cha 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 Tam Chu Nyo Yan Chi Dao Lu Man Sir Chang Hura Yang Lan Da Da Oma Ra Ba Za Na 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 Umara Bazanada, Sidna Jijim Jero was irregi, Dalu Damambarazan. Quadan Damjo Zonlu Dobaye, Lodu Rubi Nava Chidus or Narje Jimbo, Sudna Nime Jam Zone Malu Jimbo Nadiata, Pakaratang on Santu Shamad. Tumba Tiji Janla Jantarlo. 各位师兄大家晚上好，首先请大家发菩提心。
First of all, may everybody listen by generating bodhicitta.
菩提心我们应该大部分的人应该知道的，菩提心就是我们大乘佛教的灵魂，也就是大乘佛教的精华。
Everybody here is probably clear that bodhicitta is the soul, the essence, and the foundation of the Mahayana tradition.
大乘佛教为什么叫大乘佛教呢? 因为有菩提心，所以就叫做大乘佛教。
The reason that the Mahayana tradition is referred to is the greater vehicle precisely because of bodhicitta.
那么小乘佛教为什么叫小乘佛教呢? 因为没有发菩提心，所以就叫做小乘佛教。
And the Hinayana tradition is referred to as the lesser vehicle because of its lack of emphasis on bodhicitta.
换句话说，如果没有菩提心，就是没有大乘佛教。
Putting it another way, we could say without bodhicitta, we wouldn't have Mahayana Buddhism.
所以大乘啊，所以菩提心啊，对我们学大乘佛教的人来说是非常非常的重要。
So for this reason, for students of Mahayana Buddhism, bodhicitta is extremely important.
如果没有菩提心的话，我们根本就没有办法学大乘佛教。
Without bodhicitta, it wouldn't even be possible for us to engage in the study of Mahayana Buddhism.
比如说我们今天这束花供养给释迦牟尼佛，那么这个功德是属于大乘佛教还是属于小乘佛教呢?
For example, these flowers that we offer to the Buddha this evening, how are we to distinguish whether this offering is made in accordance with the motivation of the lower vehicle or the greater vehicle?
那么同样的佛,同样的佛,同样的公平,有不同的结果。
The same offerings, the same flowers, and the same Buddha images to which they're offered can have different results.
那么不同的结果是什么呢? 为什么有不同的结果呢? 在这个当中起到决定性的作用, 关键的作用是什么呢? 就是我们的发心。
The result or the different results that the same offering can manifest hinge entirely on the motivation with which we make our offering.
那么我们发了菩提心, 把这束花供养给佛,这就是大乘佛教的心善。
If we make this offering of flowers to the Buddha with the aspiration of bodhicitta, then we have engaged in a virtuous action according to the Mahayana tradition.
如果没有发菩提心,把这束花供养给佛,那么这个功德就不是大乘,不属于大乘佛教,而属于小乘佛教,或者是人天成。
Without bodhicitta, the same offering of flowers to the Buddha does not carry the merit of Mahayana Buddhism. The merit or the result that it produces is the merit of the Hinayana tradition or of a Buddhism underpinned by worldly motivations.
那么菩提心,怎么样发菩提心呢? 我们简单的说,我们首先要了解一下什么叫做菩提心。
So how do we go about generating bodhicitta? First of all, we need to be clear about what we mean by this term. What is bodhicitta?
菩提心需要两个条件,只要具备这两个条件,就叫做菩提心。
There are two criteria that need to be met in order to satisfy bodhicitta.
那么两个条件当中,第一个是什么呢? 就是慈悲心。
The first of these criteria is compassion.
慈悲心,我们明天也要继续讲这个慈悲心的具体的这个方法。简单的说,今天我们简单的说,慈悲心就是我们发自内心的希望天下所有的众生远离所有的痛苦。 这样子的心叫做悲心。
In terms of concrete practices of compassion, we're going to go into it in more detail tomorrow, but for the time being, this evening, we can say simply that bodhicitta is the aspiration to that all living beings be completely free of suffering.
然后我们发自内心的希望天下所有的众生 拥有心腹,这个心,这样子的心叫做慈。
And at the same time that all living beings attain happiness.
然后我们首先要了解一下这个天下所有众生的痛苦。当我们了解了众生有痛苦这样子的时候,我们的心中就会产生 希望他们离苦得乐,这样子的心。
First of all, it's necessary for us to gain an understanding and appreciation of the suffering of all living beings. And once we've achieved this understanding, then in our minds we will generate a strong aspiration that they be free from suffering and obtain happiness.
当我们希望天下所有的众生离苦得乐这样子的时候呢,然后我们会想办法,这个怎么样能够让天下所有的众生离苦得乐,我们会去寻找这个方法。
So upon wishing very sincerely that all living beings be free from suffering and attain happiness, we will begin to think about how we can go about doing this. We will start to search for means to see this take place in reality.
然后我们寻找这个方法的时候呢，我们会发现，目前我们没有能力让天下所有众生离苦得乐，连我们自己都没有办法离苦得乐。那么这个时候呢，我们去寻找这个方法，我们会发现，方法就是成佛，成了佛才能够让天下所有的众生。
But when we start to turn our minds to how we are going to go about ridding all living beings of suffering, we'll soon discover, in fact, that we do not have any means. We're ill-equipped for this goal. We're not even able to solve our own suffering, let alone the suffering of others. So it's at this time that we will discover that the only way is to achieve Buddhahood, and to use this as our means in order to assist other beings in being free from suffering and obtaining happiness.
这个时候我们就下决心，我一定要成佛，我要为了让天下所有的众生离苦得乐，我一定要成佛。这个时候就会生起一个这样子的决心。
And at this point, we will make the resolve that in order to assist other beings in leaving suffering and achieving happiness, we ourselves must obtain Buddhahood.
这个决心就是菩提心的第二个条件。
And it's this resolve or this aspiration that is the second criteria of bodhicitta.
那么第一个条件，我们对所有的众生的慈悲心。第二个条件呢，我们 为了度一切众生，我一定要成佛，就这种决心，这两个加起来叫做菩提心。
So bodhicitta is a combination of these two criteria. First of all, the compassion we have for all living beings, and secondly, the aspiration to achieve Buddhahood in order that they may be free of suffering.
这个慈悲心就是菩提心的基础，这个慈悲心 它是没有任何的界限，它没有种族的界限，没有国界，然后就是没有这个生命的这个级别，比如说包括动物，包括其他的生命，没有任何的这样子的界限，就这个叫做大慈大悲。
So this compassion, this great compassion that forms the foundation of bodhicitta is completely without limits. It's completely without borders or distinctions. It extends to everybody regardless of their ethnicity or race, and it extends to all living beings regardless of whether they're human or non-human.
好，这个菩提心呢，我们对我们从我们目前的情况来看的话， 我们可能是很多人来说这个离这个菩提心还有一点点距离，但是这个没问题的。只要我们愿意花一点时间去学习、去修心这样子的话，这菩提心我们每一个人都一定会有的，一定将来我们每一个人一定会升起菩提心的。
Perhaps many people might feel at this present point in time that bodhicitta is something that lies at some distance from where they are. Never mind with the resolve to diligently commit ourselves to study and to practice, bodhicitta is something that is absolutely within the scope of everybody to be able to generate for themselves.
好，这样子我们简单的给大家介绍了菩提心。这样子的话，接下来我们听课的时候，请大家发菩提心。我今天为什么要来听课呢？我要让天下所有众生离苦得乐，所以我要成佛。为了成佛，我今天听这堂课，这样子发菩提心。
So, having briefly introduced what bodhicitta is, we reflect in relation to our motivation for listening to tonight's class, to tonight's teaching. We've come here to listen in order to be of benefit to other beings. And in order to be of benefit to other beings, we need to attain Buddhahood. And in order to attain Buddhahood, we are listening to this class tonight. So it's with this mind, this aspiration that we listen to tonight's teaching.
好，接下来我们就将今天的这个主体的这个壳，那么今天的这个壳的题目呢，今天、明天、后天这三天，我们要讲三主要道。
So we'll move on now to the topic of this evening's teaching. For the next 3 days, we are going to be teaching on the three principal aspects of the path to liberation.
三主要道是在这个藏传佛教里面呢，非常非常的重视这三个道啊。宗喀巴大师把释迦牟尼佛的84000个法门归纳为三种要点啊，三种特别特别重要的要点。那么这三个要点就是三主要道。
The three principal aspects of the path is a tradition that is very esteemed in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. In this text, Tsongkhapa has condensed the 84,000 paths of the Buddha's teachings into three principal aspects.
那么这三个主要道是哪三个呢？首先是出离心，第一个出离心，第二个就是菩提心，第三个是证悟空性的智慧，这三个叫做三主要道。
And these three principal aspects of the path are firstly renunciation, secondly bodhicitta, and thirdly a correct view of emptiness.
那么在这个学佛的这个道路上有很多很多的道、有很多道，但是这些所有的修道，所有的道可以归纳为三个最最最关键的三个道，就是出离心、菩提心，然后空心见，只要有这三个道，然后我们能够成佛。
Within the Buddhist tradition, there are a great number of different paths. However, all of these paths can be condensed to these three principal paths. With renunciation, bodhicitta, and a correct view of emptiness, it is possible for us to achieve Buddhahood.
那么我们这三个道对我们学佛的人来说相当的重要，因为我们很多人想学佛而且我们想学佛的人越来越多，但是呢，很多很多的人就不知道怎么样学佛学佛到底怎么学，从哪里入手很多人都不知道。
Learning about these three paths is extremely important. These days, there are a great number of people who are interested in learning Buddhism, in practicing Buddhism, but they're not entirely sure where to start and how to go about doing this.
那么对这样子的人来说，这个三个主要道是一个我们学佛的指南特别特别重要，就是像指南针一样，这个特别特别的重要。
So for such people, the three principal aspects of the path is like a guideline, a compass.
同样这个三个主要道也就像导航就像我们车子上的导航一样，只要有出离心和菩提心和空心见这样子的话，那么我们一定会准确无误地走入大乘的这个解脱道。所以这是一个对我们这个学佛的人来说，这三个道是相当的重要。
Or we could liken the three paths to a GPS system in a car. As long as we have renunciation, bodhicitta, and a correct view of emptiness, then without fail we will be able to proceed along the Mahayana path to liberation.
那么今天我们首先菩提的三主要道里面，我们今天就将这个上，我们把这个三主要道就分成上中下这样子三个阶段，我们今天就将第一个阶段。
So we're going to divide the three paths into three sections, and this evening we're going to talk about the first section or the first stage.
首先我们要记住，俗话说得非常好，有一句话就叫做选择比努力更重要这个在佛教里面也是这样子，我们的选择上面不能有错误，所以选择是比努力更加的重要。
There's a common saying that puts it very well, and the saying is that our choices are more important than our effort. It's extremely important that we don't make a mistaken choice. Therefore, we can say that it's indeed the case that our choices are more important than our efforts.
如果我们的选择是错误的话，那么我们的所有的这个努力所有的这个努力都是徒劳，都是没有用的。
The reason being that if our choices at the outset are incorrect, then all of our effort and diligence then come, that comes after that will all be in vain.
如果我们的选择没有错的话，就是在这个选择的基础上。稍微有一点点稍微有一点努力，稍微下一点功夫的话，都是有回报的，都是有结果的。
On the other hand, if our choices are accurate and correct at the very beginning, then even if we just make a small amount of effort along these correct paths, then we will surely have reap great fruits for our efforts.
好，这样子我们今天就讲这个。三个选择，佛教的三个原则。
So tonight we're going to talk about the three choices in Buddhism.
那么佛教的三个原则是什么呢？也叫做三乘佛教三乘佛教就是大乘佛教、小乘佛教、人天佛教，这三个叫做三乘佛教。
So these three choices can also be referred to as the three vehicles of Buddhism, the Mahayana vehicle, the Hinayana vehicle, and then the worldly vehicle.
那这样子的话，我们首先我们要问自己要问自己，我们到底要学哪一条路？我们到底要走哪一条路？我们是要学人天佛教，还是要学小乘佛教，还是学大乘佛教？我们到底选择哪一条路？首先要确定这个路是最关键的。
So to begin with, we need to ask ourselves, what road are we going to pursue? What scope of motivation are we going to follow? Is it going to be the greater vehicle, the lesser vehicle, or the worldly vehicle?
我们现在很多人的这个学佛的方式我们自以为是在学佛，实际上根本就没有学佛，因为我们还没有这样子的选择，所以我们根本就还没有学佛。
There are many people these days who consider themselves to be students of Buddhism, but in actual fact are not. The reason being that they haven't yet engaged in this choice about their scope of religious motivation.
比如说，我们学佛的人当中，大部分的人的这个发心大部分的人的这个学佛的方式，或者是学佛的目的是什么样子呢？我们平时到寺庙去烧香拜佛烧香拜佛。那么，为什么烧香拜佛呢？目的就是为了健康，为了长寿为了发财，为了工作顺利。为了这些，我们求佛祖的保佑。那么这个叫做求佛，还不叫学佛。
There are many people whose scope of motivation, and in fact their mode of practicing Buddhism, really entails going to the temple, making incense offerings, supplicating the Buddha for things like prosperity, good health, good fortune in this lifetime. This kind of practice, in actuality, should be described as supplicating the Buddha or making requests of the Buddha, but certainly not studying Buddhism.
比如说，我们大年三十的时候，每年的大年三十的时候，比如说在中国大陆北京的雍和宫，还有比如说四川成都的文殊院等等，这些大型的寺庙里面呢，都有8万个人、10万个人， 或者是十一二万个人去烧香。
For example, on the auspicious days of the Chinese New Year, it's very common to see tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of people crowding in temples making incense offerings.
雍和宫啊，还有就是像成都的文殊院等等，啊，就是每年有这么多人去啊，这个烧香。那这个时候呢？媒体啊，电视台的记者就跟着他们去问他们，问他们你们为什么要去这个烧香呢？为什么这么多人去烧香？你们目的是什么呢？啊，这样子去问。
Quite often there are journalists present at such occasions, and they frequently ask the people making offerings why they are doing this, what is their motivation.
然后。很多人，凡是被问的人都回答：“我就是希望我们家里的人健康啊，我们一家人这一年啊平平安安啊。”就是大家的回答都是这样子的。
And most people respond that I'm doing this in order for the sake of the health of my family and for the safety and well-being of our entire family.
啊，我想。国外的这个学佛的人可能情况也就差不多，也就是这样子的。
I think perhaps that the situation for people overseas is much the same as this.
那么我们啊，希望我们的这个家人或者是亲戚朋友这一年当中平平安安，一切顺利，这有问题吗？当然是没有问题的。
Of course, hoping that our family and near ones are in good health and enjoy well-being and no obstacles. Is this problematic? No, it's not problematic.
啊，这个心态啊，我们大家都会有的啊，可以理解的。这个当然是没有问题的。但是呢，如果我们的这个学佛的目的，也就是这一点的话，那就是不划算。
This kind of hope is something that everybody has, and it's something we can understand. However, if this is solely our motivation for studying Buddhism, it's really not enough.
啊，这个就叫做这个求佛。还有我们啊，平时我们以为什么叫学佛呢？我们以为这个烧香啊，拜佛。我们很多人觉得这个叫做学佛，其实这个不叫学佛，这个叫做供佛。
So, making, supplicating the Buddha, making requests of the Buddha is one thing. Another mode of Buddhist practice that people often conflate with Buddhist practice is making offerings to the Buddha.
然后我们就是当我们遇到一些在工作上在这个生活当中。遇到一些问题的时候，遇到一些困难的时候呢，我们到寺庙去求佛，然后呢，给佛说，佛，我给你烧香，然后呢，你要给我保佑。如果你给我保佑，我这个生意做得好的话，那我也给你修苗什么什么来回答，回报。我们会这样子去求佛，这个不叫学佛，这个叫做求佛。
For example, people may, when they encounter hardships or patches of roughness in their personal lives or in their working lives, may go to the temple and make an offering to the Buddha and say, Buddha or Bodhisattva, please protect me. And if you do, if everything gets better, then I will repay you, I'll build a temple and I'll do all of these kinds of things. In actual fact, this isn't studying Buddhism, requesting, making requests, supplicating the Buddha.
但是我们很多人不知道，我们以为这个就是学佛。
But many people are not aware of this. They think that this is in fact being a student of Buddhism.
这个不仅仅是在中国大陆，而且东南亚很多其他国家的佛教徒也是这样子。我想，西方的很多佛教徒可能也许是这样子。
This is not just the case in mainland China, it's also the situation in countries in Southeast Asia and in other places as well. It's also possible that it's the case in Western countries as well.
那么我们为什么有一个这样子的想法呢？就是因为我们缺乏了，这个佛教的系统的教育，所以我们很多人不知道到底什么叫做学佛。
And the reason that people have such mistaken ideas about what being a student of Buddhism is due to a lack of systematic learning of Buddhism.
那么我们就是我们刚才讲的，比如说我们希望我们平安，然后就是遇到问题的时候，我们求佛这个祈祷佛，求佛祖的保佑这些都是没有问题的。但是呢，我们的学佛的目的不能仅仅这一点平时我们有必要的时候呢，可以去求佛，也可以去供佛，这些都。并不是说这些有什么问题，这些都可以的。但是呢，我们的这个学佛，真正的学佛呢，不是这些，是另外一个。
Of course, making offerings to the Buddha and making requests of the Buddha in order for health and well-being, or when we encounter difficulties, is okay. When we have a need for such, when we have such moments, it's okay to do this. However, our motivation for studying Buddhism can't be reduced just to this.
所以大家一定要问自己我们为什么要学佛我学佛，我想得到什么呢？我学佛，我想达到什么目的呢？这个必须要问自己。首先，我们要把路确定了以后再上路。
So everybody really needs to ask themselves what their motivation in studying Buddhism is. What is it that they hope to gain from studying Buddhism? What kind of result it is that they hope to obtain? It's important at the outset that we designate properly the path we're going to follow.
就像我们用这个导航系统的时候呢，首先我们要把目的地要写进去输入了以后呢，才能够它把我们带到目的地，我们才能够达到这个目的地。同样的，首先我们要学大乘、学小乘，还是学人天乘，这个必须要准备好，确定了以后再学这样子才叫做正确的路，正确的学佛。
So just as we need to first input our destination on our GPSs in order for them to be able to take us properly to where we want to go, so too with our Buddhist study and practice, we need to work out at the outset whether we are going to be students of the Mahayana, Hinayana, or worldly traditions.
好，今天我们就讲这个三个选择当中的前面的两个。
So, of these three possible scopes of motivation, tonight we're going to talk about the two first ones.
好，前面的两个是什么呢？第一个叫做人天佛教，或者也叫做人天乘。
So, the first of these scopes of motivation is what we refer to as a motivation for studying Buddhism that revolves around happiness in this current life.
人天乘是什么样子呢？比如说，我们有些人呢，他想我不想成佛，我也不想往生西方极乐世界我也不想解脱，我这些都不需要那么我就求一个这个幸福的生活这一生当中，我也就是能够过上一个幸福的生活，然后下一世再下一世。生生死死能够过上一个幸福的这个生活其他我什么都不求有这样子的人。
So this scope of motivation is one where we do not seek enlightenment, we don't seek rebirth in Amitabha's pure land. We are concerned with having a happy life in this current life as well as in future existences to come.
好，这种人适合学什么样的这个佛怎样学佛呢？那么这种人就适合学人天乘。
So, a person with this kind of motivation is is what kind of Buddhist approach are they suited to studying? They are suited to studying a worldly kind of Buddhism.
好，人天称是什么意思呢？人天称就是我们啊，下一世啊再回来，回到人间啊，或者是回到这个天，投身到这个天人当中，然后继续享受人天的福报啊，就是在人间啊，或者是在天人当中，过上这个人和天人的生活啊，这个就叫做人天称。
So this worldly Buddhism, or Buddhism with worldly motivations, is one where we aspire to either future rebirth as a human or in the realms of the gods, where we can enjoy happiness in one of these kinds of existences.
那么我们要学这样子的佛的话，需要什么条件呢？就需要两个条件。
If we want to pursue this kind of Buddhist study, then we only need to satisfy two criteria.
那么两个条件当中的第一个就是我们相信轮回人的前世后世这样子的存在。
The first is that we need to believe in samsara, cyclic existence,previous lives and future lives.
相信轮回的存在，这是第一个条件。
This is the first criteria.
第二个条件呢？相信善恶因果，善恶因果，善有善报，恶有恶报。
And the second is a belief in karma and karmic cause and effect, that positive actions yield positive results.And negative actions yield negative results.
好，这个就是它的条件。只要有这两个条件啊，相信轮回，相信这个善恶因果，然后尽量的心善端恶啊，这样子的话呢，那么他就可以下一世、再下一世、生生死死啊，可以投身到人间啊，或者是投身到这个天人当中啊，这样子的这个方法叫做。人天称。
So with this belief in cyclic existence, as well as a belief in karmic cause and effect, coupled with efforts to do positive actions and avoid negative actions, it's possible for a student or a follower of this approach to attain human birth, rebirths in future existences.
好，如果我们学这样子的佛啊，走这条路，如果我们的选择就是这个的话，那就我们下一世可以不堕地狱，可以不堕畜生啊，可以不堕恶鬼，但是呢，没有办法解脱啊，不能解脱，我们只能在人间或者是在天人当中啊，继续啊，享受这个人天的福报，只能这样子。
So with this scope of motivation, it's possible for us to avoid rebirth in the lower three realms, but it's not possible for us to achieve liberation. So we'll be able to achieve rebirth as a human or in the realm of the gods, but it's not possible for us to leave cyclic existence.
那如果我们走这条路的话，那么生老病死啊，这样子的痛苦是没有办法解决的。
It's not possible for us to overcome samsara by following this approach.
但是如果因为每一个人的根基不一样每个人的这个目标不一样，需求不一样，所以如果我们只想这一点如果其他的解脱什么都不考虑的话，那也可以走这样子的路，也可以选择这条路。
Of course, everybody's needs and capacities are different. If you are someone who isn't interested or concerned with liberation or other aims, then it is permissible to be a student of Buddhism with this kind of basic motivation.
那么这条路呢，它需要有这个相信因果、相信这个轮回这样子的条件。那么我们刚才讲的，比如说我们 当我们遇到问题的时候呢，临时去报佛教啊，平时我们不相信因果，不相信轮回，然后也不去信善啊，就是遇到问题的时候就临时去报佛教啊，就求佛这样子的，这种方法呢，连人天成也不是。
So this most basic scope of motivation requires the belief in cyclic existence and the belief in karma and its cause and effects, as well as an undertaking to do good actions and avoid negative actions. If we simply turn to the Buddha when we are in a patch of difficulty, then this kind of practice completely lacking the belief in the two previously mentioned things does not correspond even with this lowest scope of motivation.
佛教就是讲因果啊，讲缘起。如果我们自己不心善啊，自己不心善，我们自己经常去造罪啊、造恶这样子的话，那么我们求佛也是没有用的，佛也是没有办法救我们。所以如果我们拥有这个心福这样子的话呢，那么还是要自己去奋斗，自己要心善端恶。
With of course Buddhism is underpinned by the doctrines of cause and effect and dependent origination. So if we think that it'sGoing to be efficacious, turning to supplicating the Buddha when we're in a difficult spot, this is clearly not going to be enough. It's important that we understand the need to undertake positive actions and to avoid those that are harmful.
那么这个这种人天成在这个佛教里面呢就是作为最低层的一个选择。
This kind of scope of motivation, which is oriented towards happiness in this life or future lives, is the most basic motivation.
所以我们尽量的不要选这样子的路，因为我们的人生是非常非常的难得，有这样子的机会，有这么多的选择。现在我们的前面有三个选择，有这样子的选择的这个机会是非常难得的，所以我们还是不要选择这个第一条路，要选第二条、第三条。
However, given the preciousness of our human birth, we would do better not to choose as our motivation this most basic one. Given the fact that we do have this precious human birth, we should set our sights higher on either the second level of motivation or the highest level of motivation.
好，那么接下来我们就要讲今天的这个比较主要的这个题目，就是第二个选择，也就是这个解脱道。
So, we're going to move on now to the main core of tonight's teaching, which is the second choice, the path of liberation.
那么解脱道就是我们的这个第二个选择那么也就是这个三主要道里面的第一个第一个道，就是我们今天讲的解脱道。
So this second choice is actually the first aspect according to tonight's teaching.
那如果我们不走这个解脱的道，然后我们就暂时就求一个人天的福报，这样子的话，那我们的最根本的问题，生老病死的问题，还是没有解决，所以这个不是最好的路。
If we don't pursue the path of liberation and instead fix our sights on happy existence in this life or future existences, then we're really not going to be able to address the basic.Conditions of samsara. So this is ultimately not an advisable choice.
那我们如果不能解脱不能解脱的话，在这个世俗红尘 或者是在我们的这个人的生活当中，我们每个人都在寻找幸福，但是真正能够得到幸福的这个时候呢，还是大家都觉得所谓的幸福，其实不是那么的完美，这个世俗当中呢，其实没有一个很准确，或者是一个没有一个很完美的幸福。 我们大家都会感觉，这个时候我们都会感觉到没有一个纯正的幸福，绝对的幸福。
In the course of our mundane lives, most of us are searching for happiness and thinking that we know ways for happiness, but in actual fact, it's extremely difficult for us to achieve perfect happiness or ultimate happiness by such worldly and mundane means.
幸福，我们讲的这个幸福，比如说人间，也不是否定这个幸福或者是快乐。释迦牟尼佛也不是否定，也不是完全否定这个人间存在幸福和快乐。
Of course, Buddhism doesn't deny entirely the existence of relative happiness in a worldly way.
虽然是有幸福，有快乐，但是呢，就是这个人间的这个我们的生活当中的幸福和快乐是相对的，不是绝对的幸福。Even
though there are happinesses and pleasures in our everyday lives, these are only relative in nature, they're not ultimate.
那么所谓的相对的幸福呢，就是实际上这个里面呢有太多太多的不幸福的。 或者是这个幸福会导致更多的不幸福、不快乐，叫做相对的幸福。When
we refer to relative happiness, what we are talking about is the fact that this happiness, or what is ostensibly happy, in fact contains many unhappinesses within it, or perhaps itself is capable of precipitating many unhappinesses.
还有一个是我们的幸福是非常非常的短暂，比如说，一个人一辈子没有遇到任何的这个痛苦，一切都是顺利，即使是这样子的话，那么这个时间也是很短暂，非常的短暂。
The other thing about this relative happiness is its short-lived and ephemeral nature. Even a person who in the course of their lifetime doesn't encounter any hardship and has a very smooth run, this lifetime in viewed from a wider spectrum is itself only a very short period of time.
所以释迦牟尼佛就是告诉我们 比如说，如果我们的生活在自己的生活当中，如果有幸福、有快乐的话，那么这个就是我们自己的过去的善的果报，善有善报，有权利享受，有资格享受这样子的幸福。What
the Buddha teaches us or taught us is that happinesses like this that we enjoy in our lifetimes are the result, the positive fruits of positive karmic actions that we sowed in previous lifetimes. Based on this, we are entitled and we have the right to enjoy these happinesses.
这是佛告诉我们，提醒我们，千万不要就是沉迷于眼前的 这一点点的这个幸福，这个幸福是我们的过去的善报，我们可以享受这个幸福，但是呢，千万不要沉迷在这样子的这个幸福当中。Yet
while we are entitled to enjoy these fruits of our previous positive karmic actions, what the Buddha teaches us is not to revel in these small happinesses that emerge in front of us.
然后佛就鼓励我们积极向上，我们享受过去的这个福报的同时，我们要积极向上，要争取 更高的心腹或者是更好的解脱。
The Buddha urges us to strive onward. So while we may enjoy these happinesses or positive fruits that are the result of previous karmic actions, we need to constantly work harder with higher aims for our liberation.
所以我们就希望大家能够就是选择第二条路，也就是走上解脱的道路。
So for this reason, I hope that everybody makes the choice to pursue this second path, the path of liberation.
那么什么叫做解脱的道路呢？很简单啊，凡是有出离心的凡是有出离心的就叫做解脱道路。
So what does the path to liberation actually refer to? This is in fact very simple. As long as we possess renunciation, the mind of renunciation, then we will be on the path to liberation.
如果我们没有出离心在没有出离心的情况下，比如说我们去烧香拜佛、念经磕头，然后做慈善做各种各样的这个行善，那么这些都是有这些都是有果报的，都是善有善报。但是呢这些果报都是我们刚刚讲的，就是第一个选择，都是人天成。
So without a mind of renunciation, then all actions or positive dharmic conduct we might engage in, from doing recitations, chanting, prostrations, making offerings, engaging in charitable activities, without renunciation, then these, the merit that we generate through such conduct, which certainly exists, there is merit. This merit, however, belongs to the realm of the worldly Buddhism that we just spoke of.
好，在这第二个选择里面呢，大家要记住这个出离心这三个字，大家要关注这三个字，这个就是我们的最主要的这个话题。
So, the main topic that we're going to address is renunciation, and particularly the three characters that this word is comprised of in Chinese.
那么，以后我们能不能走上解脱的道路，完全就是取决于有没有出离心。
From here on, whether or not we're able to proceed along the path to liberation hinges precisely or entirely on whether or not we have this renunciation.
有出离心就是走上解脱道。没有出离心，在没有出离心的情况下，我们信任何一种善都不能让我们解脱。
With renunciation, we are on the path to liberation. However, without renunciation, then any positive act we may engage in will not assist us in this way.
好，那么什么叫做出离心呢？我们接下来给大家介绍出离心。
So what actually do we mean by renunciation? Let's talk about this now.
首先我们要知道出离心也有需要有两个条件，就像我们刚才讲菩提心的时候，菩提心有如果具备两个条件就叫做菩提心，同样的出离心就有出离心的两个条件。
So just as we talked about in relation to bodhicitta, the two criteria of bodhicitta, so too does renunciation have two conditions that need to be met in order for its quality to be fulfilled.
第一个是什么？第一个条件是什么呢？我们要知道这个轮回是很苦的，包括我们的人生还有天人等等。虽然我们的生活当中会有幸福，会有快乐，这一点佛也不会否定，这些都有。但是呢，总体来说人有生老病死，还有太多太多的精神上的痛苦，肉体上的痛苦，所以总体来说，轮回是很痛苦的。
The first thing we need to do is have an appreciation of the suffering of samsara. mental suffering, physical suffering, even though it is true that we will also have moments of happiness, overall, it is important that we generate an understanding of the suffering of cyclic existence.
轮回痛哭啊，轮回就是痛哭这两个字啊，我们很多人听到了以后呢，很多人都不理解，很多人觉得这样子就如果说轮回是痛哭啊，这样子的话，很多人觉得这个是一个很消极啊，很悲观的说法。
A lot of people, when confronted with the statement that samsara is suffering, feel that this is an extremely pessimistic and overly negative way of looking at things.
其实这个不是一个消极和悲观，为什么呢？首先我们要知道我们目前存在的这些问题，这一点我们一定要承认，一定要肯定，肯定了以后呢？ 我们就去寻找一个解决这个问题的方法。所以下一个我们知道我们有问题的时候呢，然后我们继续去寻找这个解决这个问题的方法。所以这是一个很积极的这个态度，根本不是一个消极。However,
this way of looking at things is actually not negative or pessimistic at all. In fact, in terms of apprehending that we have a problem and on that basis seeking to find means to solve it, this is actually an extremely active, a proactive approach.
再说，这个不是悲观，为什么不是悲观？如果我们说轮回很痛苦，什么都是没有意思的，很痛苦，然后也没有说怎么去解决，能不能够解决这些方法都没有。 只是告诉我们人生很苦，没有意思，活着没有意义，生活没有意义。这样子的话，那么当然这个就是一个很消极，是一个很消极的、很悲观的这个态度。Of
course, if we only said that life is suffering, life is without hope, life is terrible, etc., without offering means for overcoming this, then yes, this would be rather pessimistic, but this is not what we're saying.
佛教就是一个非常积极的人生态度，佛教的人生观是一个非常积极的人生态度，而且也是一个很乐观的人生态度，它根本不是一个悲观的。
In actual fact, the Buddhist approach and the Buddhist worldview is very active, it's very proactive, it's not pessimistic in any way.
比如说，我们很多人不敢去体检，为什么不敢体检呢？我们很多人害怕，会不会医生告诉我，我体检了以后呢，会不会哪里有一个肿瘤，而且已经弯曲了，就是他会不会告诉我这样子的事情，我会不会听到这样子的声音？所以我不敢去体检。很多人是这样子，那这个能够解决问题吗？根本就不能解决问题的。
A lot of people, for example, are afraid of going to the doctor for a health checkup. They're concerned that the doctor will find that they have a tumor, and not only that, but it's in its advanced stages. And so, given their fear for hearing such bad news, they decide that they are not going to go and have a checkup at all. But this is, in fact, not any kind of approach to take. It doesn't solve any problems at all.
有一天我们不能不面对这个生病的这个痛苦，一直都不去体检，然后又不去治疗，那么这样子的话，只有到时候面对这个病痛的痛苦。
The reason being that sooner or later we have no choice but to face the reality of sickness and death.
这个就是一个非常逃避的，这是一个非常逃避的一个逃避现实，不敢面对现实的一个现象。So
by not going to the doctor and having a checkup, this is really just avoiding reality.
那么这个时候呢，勇敢的面对现实，体检，然后要发现自己如果身体有问题的话，那及时的去治疗，这样子的话。 还来得及，还可以救自己的生命。
If we were to courageously approach reality, go and have the health checkup, discover that we perhaps had the tumor, but then seek treatment for it, then we might actually have some hope. We might be in time.
同样的啊，我们在生活当中，我们都是这样子，就像死亡、衰老这样子的这个话题，我们平时都不敢去想啊，也就是不敢面对。然后呢，我们不敢去谈这个死亡这两个字啊，就一直都在回避啊。但是它是一个事实，我们再逃避、再回避，就是没有办法逃避。
And this kind of avoidance of reality or shirking away from the inevitable is something that we commonly feel. We don't want to talk about aging and sickness and death. We don't want to think about it. But this is ultimately something that we have no choice not to face.
然后我们永远都会说，啊，我们的未来是光明的，我们的未来是幸福的。而我们永远都会告诉自己，或者是告诉他人。
And instead of facing these hard facts of our inevitable future, we tell ourselves and other people that our future is so bright and so full of hope.
然后我们很多人，也就是以为啊，自己的生命当中会发生很多很多非常精彩的事情，或者是。希望在自己的生命当中会发生很多精彩的事情。
And like this, many people are of the belief, or they at least hope, that in the future many wonderful things will happen to them.
但是我们绝大多数的人的生命当中没有发生任何的什么精彩的事情。我们的未来，大家都说是光明，但是我们的未来是什么呢？我们最终的未来是衰老，衰老以后就是死亡，这个不是光明。
But for the vast majority of people, these wonderful things in fact don't happen. For most people, what lies ahead for them is aging and death.
但是我们平时我们不敢去想这么多啊。就像我们不敢去体检一样，我们不敢去做说这些事情，我们就只看眼前啊，不看啊，不谈，不看啊，然后呢，不为这些事情做准备。
But just as we avoid going and having a health checkup, so too do we avoid thinking and talking about these topics. We instead keep our gaze fixed on that which is squarely in front of us.
所以我们平时都是用我们的未来是光明幸福，我明天更加的幸福等等啊，就是以这样的这些词汇来覆盖我们的这个生活或者是生命的真相。
So we use words like brightness and hope in relation to the future to essentially conceal the truth of the reality of our existences.
那么按理来说，我们今天21世纪，我们的物质生活、交通、通讯各方面的这个，我们今天我们的生活当中的，一个常用的东西，就是几百年前的人连做梦都梦不到的这些事情，今天我们就已经变成了一个日常用品。按理来说，我们应该是很幸福的。
In principle, we should be extremely happy in our current age, given the affluence of our existences, the advanced material lives that we enjoy, the developed state of our communications and technology, etc. Certainly, based on the standards of a person who lived 1,000 years ago, we...By rights, should be extremely happy today.
然后我们很多人也觉得啊，当我们还没有发财的时候，没有这个经济不怎么样的时候呢，我们大家都觉得，只要有一天啊，我有想有多少钱就有多少钱， 这样子的话，那么我一定会很幸福的。我就是要为了这个目标奋斗。我们大家的想法都是这样子的。
And similarly, a lot of people do think, if they're before or until they have made a lot of money, they are of the view that their happiness will dawn essentially when they achieve wealth or when they achieve riches, and so they fix their goal on achieving these things.
然而，我们因为有了一个这样子的啊，我们有了一个这样子的期望，对我们的这些轮回或者我们生的这些物质有一个过高的啊这个期望，我们高估了它的实际的价值啊。这样子以后呢，我们啊，一辈子奋斗啊，然后真正有一天，发财了以后呢，然后我们会发现啊，原来不是这样子，还有很多很多的问题没有解决，还有很多很多的痛苦存在。
But in actual fact, thinking like this, we overestimate the value of these goals. On the day that we actually end up making all of this money and becoming very rich, we will discover that in actual fact, there are all kinds of problems that are still yet to be resolved. There are all kinds of challenges that still lie ahead of us.
佛教不是啊，否定物质在我们的生活当中起到的这个作用，或者是物质的这个价值啊。但是呢，佛教就是告诉我们，其实物质不是我们所想象的这样子。即使是我们有了所有的，拥有了我们啊这个拥有了庞大的物质财富，但是呢，实际上我们人的问题还是没有解决。
Of course, Buddhism doesn't deny a certain utility and value of material things in our lives. However, what it does assert is that even if we have great riches in terms of material objects, we still will have not addressed and solved all of our problems.
那么我们，当我们没有这些物质的时候呢，我们为了这个物质啊，大家都忙碌啊，大家都辛苦。然后呢，有了这些物质的时候呢，然后我们会发现更多的精神上的痛苦。
Of course, when we don't or aren't in a position to enjoy these material objects, then we work towards getting them with much busyness and we make lots of efforts to attain them. However, once we actually have arrived at a point where we're able to enjoy an advanced material existence, then we discover, in fact, all kinds of other suffering.
即使是我们拥有了这个庞大的物质财富，然后呢，精神上也没有什么啊，这个痛苦啊，心灵很健康。即使是这样子的话，那么这个时间也是很短暂，很短暂。
This suffering, this mental suffering, even if it is the case that after we have arrived at a point of material richness that we don't suffer any kind of mental suffering, this state is in itself extremely short-lived and ephemeral.
所以我们就在这个轮回当中，就在我们的生活当中，要找到一个绝对的幸福，真正的幸福的话，这个真的是很难的。
So,It's extremely difficult for this reason in psychic existence to discover an ultimate kind of happiness.
所以释迦牟尼佛给我们啊给我们指了另外一条路，另外一种方法。
So what the Lord Buddha provided to us was an alternative path, an alternative strategy.
那么这个方法呢是。提升我们自己的这个生命的级别啊，提升我们自己的生命的级别，然后通过这种方法，我们可以超越啊这个生老病死。
And what this alternative path or means was a way to enhance or increase the level of our human existence, and in so doing to transcend.Samsara.
所以佛就告诉我们啊，我们的这个生命呢， 并不是我们所想象的就这么几十年，这个几十年过去了以后呢，未来的路还有很多很多，所以佛就告诉我们，还是我们想办法超越这个轮回，超越就叫做解脱，解脱了以后呢，才能够享受到真正的幸福。
So what the Buddha did teach was that this human life of ours is not as short as it appears. In actual fact, it goes on, it extends on for much longer. The true way to achieving happiness is to transcend psychic existence itself, and this is what the Buddha taught means to achieving.
然后为什么要解脱，为什么要超越呢？ 就是因为第一个，因为这个轮回很痛苦，所以要超越。第二个，即使是我们在轮回当中的这个该拥有的都拥有了，所谓的这个轮回当中的幸福，我们都拥有了。但是呢，这个时间是非常非常的短暂，所以佛告诉我们不要沉迷于眼前的这个一点点的幸福，还是要超越，还是要。 还是要我们的要求要高一点，目标要设得高一点，就是这样子的意思。So
the reason that the Buddha taught it's necessary for us to transcend or go beyond samsaric existence is because either samsaric existence is suffering, or even if it doesn't currently appear to be so, this period of relative happiness is in fact only very brief. So it is necessary for us to turn our sights to ultimate liberation.
第一个就是我们要对这个轮回，或者对我们的生命，或者对我们的世界，生活需要有一个正确的认识，不要去高估它，不要高估它，不要过高的期望，就是要正视轮回，正视自己的生命和生活。
The first thing that we need to do is have an accurate, realistic appraisal of the value of psychic existence, our own lives, and yes, our own existences.
这个就是出离心的第一个条件，就是我们在这个生活当中、生命当中，发现了太多太多的不完美的。 太多太多的这个痛苦，太多太多的不幸，这样子以后呢，我们就会开始离开它，开始超越它，有这个想法，所以这是它的第一个条件。So
this is the first condition of renunciation, the discovery of the many imperfections and sufferings in samsara, and the generation of a mind that turns away from these things.
如果我们不觉得这个轮回有痛苦，不觉得轮回有苦，不觉得轮回有多，怎么样？我们觉得轮回很好呀，这样子的话呢，那么可以走我们刚才讲的第一条路，就是第一个选择，那么继续走这条路，继续走这个我们的轮回的路，也就是人天乘。
If for whatever reason we don't think that samsara is that bad, it doesn't seem to be filled with that much suffering, then we can pursue the first kind of Buddhism or Buddhist motivation that we described, that which is focused on happiness within samsaric existence.
我们的眼前就有这么多的路，有这么多的选择，没有一个人来强迫我们。 一定要选择某一条路，一定要走某一条路，到底要走哪一条路，还是自己决定，自己选择。Of
these possibilities, these paths that we are presented with, there is nobody standing there forcing us, insisting that we pursue one path or the other. Ultimately, the choice as to which path we follow is very much our own.
所以，如果我们不觉得人生有多苦，不觉得轮回有多苦，我们还是觉得轮回还是很不错的，还是很幸福的。这样子，至少我们暂时，根本就没有办法接受这个轮回痛苦的这种概念，这样子的话，那就这个就是我们，这就是说明我们应该走这个。 人田城。
So if we, for the time being, don't feel that samsara is that bad, we think it seems quite okay, if we're not able to accept for the time being the notion that samsara is filled with many shortcomings, then we should pursue or adopt as our motivation that which is oriented towards happiness in this and future existences.
但是这样子的想法啊，我们必须要知道，我们为什么有这样子的想法？那是因为我们不了解这个轮回的真相啊，不了解轮回的真相。我们了解的，我们看到的，或者我们接触到的这一切，都是这个轮回的一个表面的现象啊。我们就是因为这个表面的现象啊，因为表面的现象。然后我们就产生了一个错觉，我们觉得啊，轮回，很幸福的，反正我现在不幸福，我很累，但是这个以后啊，我应该可以有更加的幸福的啊，等等，我们的这个想法是因为不了解轮回导致的。
However, we should know that if this is the case, our failure to appreciate the shortcomings of samsara is because we don't understand the truth of its nature. In fact, what we understand or perceive to be quite an okay existence is only a very superficial understanding, and this superficial understanding results in a distorted perception, the idea that even if I'm not happy right now, things will get better in the future. So this is ultimately based on a lack of an understanding of the truth of cyclic existence.
好，这样子的时候呢，我们啊应该多了解一下这个轮回，我们稍微啊稍微就这个了解一下轮回的这个真相，或者是往深的方面啊去了解一下，这样子我们或者是我们啊就看一下整个的这个轮回的全经的图啊，我们现在看到的呢，从时间的角度来看，我们看到的是轮回当中的就是一个很小很小很小的段落，其他的我们都没有看到。从空间的角度来看的话，我们现在看到的轮回呢，也就是轮回的很小很小的一部分，所以我们其他的都没有看到。所以我们因为不了解，所以我们不认为它很痛苦多可怕。
If this were the case, we would do well to really probe deeper into the nature of samsara. Indeed, what we experience ourselves as psychic existence is only a very, very small representation of the overall spectrum of what is comprised by samsara. So given the very restricted, very subjective, small understanding we have of samsara, this results in a distorted and mistaken understanding of its nature.
那么这样子下去的话，我们啊，总有一天我们会发现啊，轮回真的是啊，不是我们所想象的这样子，是很恐怖的啊，是很痛苦的啊，总有一天我们会发现，但是呢啊，那个时候呢，一切都来不及，所以我们啊，应该现在就应该有一点准备。
Eventually, of course, we'll discover that psychic existence is in fact terrifying, it is in fact very painful, but at that point it will be too late. So for this reason, it is advisable that we start to put in the preparatory work sooner.
然后呢，我们同时我们也要深入的去思考一下我们自己的生存的目标啊，生存的意义到底是什么？这个我们也得要去考虑，要去思考。
Another thing that we really need to contemplate seriously is the value, the significance, and the goals of our human lives.
我们平时啊，平时我们这个工作啊，工作大家很辛苦，压力很多很大，然后就是生活的节奏越来越快，然后竞争啊，就是也是很激烈。那在这样子的情况下，大家都很辛苦，大家都很辛苦啊，那么感觉不到 真正的幸福在哪里。但是呢，我们总是觉得幸福就在这个后面啊，我们这样子下去，我一定会幸福，永远都是这么认为。
A lot of people in the course of their working lives feel very stressed, they feel a lot of pressure, they suffer the effects of working in and operating in very competitive environments. But despite all of this, they are of the view that their happiness lies just around the corner, their happiness is waiting for them tomorrow.
那么我们啊要问自己啊，我们面对这么多的压力啊，然后面对这么多的压力，这么辛苦去工作啊，为什么？这个是为什么呢？啊，就这个回答很简单，这个答案很简单，就是为了赚钱。
However, if we're going to ask ourselves, quite frankly, why it is that we endure so much hardship and so much pressure in our work lives, why it is that we are willing to do this, then the answer is very simple. We endure all of this to make money.
那么为什么要赚钱呢？非常简单，我们大家都会说为了生存。
And why is it that we need to make money? Everybody, of course, will answer this is very obvious. We need money in order to survive.
所以我们可以说，工作的目标就是赚钱，啊，赚钱的目标就是生存。
So we could say that the purpose of work is to make money, and the purpose of making money is to survive or exist.
那么接下来的回答呢？问题呢？我们有点不好回答啊。生存的目的是什么呢？然后我们就不知道生存的目的应该是什么。生存的目的是不是为了生存呢？如果我们说生存的目标是生存啊，那这样子呢，意思就是说生存的目标是没有目标的。
But if we were to push this question one step further and ask, why is it that we need to exist? What is the purpose of existing? Then it becomes more difficult. If we answer that the purpose of existence is existence itself, then it actually shows that there is no point in existence at all.
那我们可以说工作的目标是赚钱，赚钱的目标是生存，然后生存的目标是什么？我们回答不出来的时候呢？这个实际上已经回答了啊，已经回答了。生存的目标真的是这样子的人，对这样子的人来说，生存的目标真的是没有别的生存的目标。所以这种人啊，心里非常的空虚，永远都不会幸福的。
So when we if we arrive at a point where we're not able to answer that question of why is it that we exist, then in fact our lack of ability to answer this question is an answer in itself. It says basically that there is no existence, no point in existence, or that we don't know what the meaning of existence is. And people who are unable to answer this question feel a great sense of emptiness, a great sense of ennui.
如果我们说生存的目标啊，就是生存啊，这样子的话，那意思就是说我们只求一个生存啊，其他我们什么想法都没有，只求一个生存啊，这样子的话跟其他的动物有什么区别呢？没有任何的区别了。
If the meaning of existence is existence itself, and this is the only thing that we hope for, then in actual fact, in terms of our goals, there's no difference between us and animals.
那么只求一个生存，没有任何其他的目标，这样子的话，那么这种人生才是真正的这个非常的悲观的人生和非常的消极的人生。
In fact, it's this kind of not only wishing for existence without any other goals that can be described as pessimistic or extremely negative in its outlook.
啊，如果用佛教的思想啊，用佛教的思想来回答这个问题的话，那么我们需要生存啊，为了生存，我们要去赚钱，为了赚钱要去工作啊，这些都是很。客观的啊，这都是需要的。但是呢，生存的目标，那么这些都不是，这些都是为了生存啊。生存的目标呢，是另外一个目标。
from a Buddhist point of view, needing to exist and needing to make money in order to exist, and in order to make money needing to work, there's no problem with this. This is all fairly straightforward. However, the meaning of existence itself, from a Buddhist point of view, needs to be set higher than simply survival.
佛教没有告诉我们不要去工作不要去赚钱不要家庭所有的放弃没有告诉我们这样的这个根本就是不现实不可能的事情这些都是需要的但是这些都是最终我们发现这一切都是为了生存那么佛教的问题是另外一个那么生存的目标到底 我们应该什么东西作为生存的目标？佛教的这个这个思想就是在这个地方，就是给我们另外一个这个方法。So
the Buddhist tradition has never said that we don't need to work, we don't need to make money, we don't need families, we don't need any of this, that we should let it all go. Of course, this is not realistic. However, what Buddhism is concerned with is the question of the meaning of existence. And it's in relation to this question that Buddhism provides us with a different approach.
如果生存的目标就是吃喝玩乐，在吃喝玩乐当中，外面的物质刺激到我们的感官，然后从中获得的一个感受，我们的生存的目标是这一点的话。
If the meaning of our existence is simply sensual gratification, whether eating, drinking, playing, etc., gratification of our senses, if this is in fact all that our existence boils down to, then this is an extremely negative outlook.
努力的去工作，努力的去赚钱，就是为了生存。生存下来了以后呢，那么就是我们应该有一个另外一件事情去做。So
if our efforts in going to work and making money are oriented towards being able to survive, then we should have, after we have guaranteed our survival, we need to have another goal that we are surviving in order to achieve.
那么我们一个人，一个生命的这个存在的价值，它不是吃喝玩乐。
In fact, the value of human existence does not lie in the gratification of various sensorial pleasures.
就像一辆车，它需要用电，需要用油，需要用水，但是呢，它的目标是不是为了燃料，耗尽这个燃料呢？ 不是它的生存的价值，不是一辆车的这个生存的价值，存在的价值，不是消耗燃料。It's
just like in the case of a car, of an automobile. It needs power, it needs electricity, it needs water, it needs gasoline in order to function. However, if we were to say that the purpose of a car is the consumption or exhaustion of electricity, power, and gasoline, it would be obvious that this is in fact not the purpose to which a car is put.
那么它的存在的价值不是消耗燃料，是什么呢？就是运输，就是作为一个交通工具，这就是它的价值，它的存在的价值。
The value of a car clearly is not the consumption of fuel, but its ability to transport people. Its essential value is its being a tool of transport.
那么我们作为一个人，作为一个这样子的这个高级的这个生命，那么它的生存的价值也不是吃喝玩乐，吃喝玩乐，佛教里面。
那没有否定这些，可都可以，但是呢，需要有一个更崇高的目标。Humans as advanced forms of life, need to have a greater or more noble goal or value for their existence. It should not less. It does not rest at the level of simply satisfying various sensorial urges.
那么这个崇高的目标是什么呢？ 佛教就觉得这个崇高的目标就是利他，利他，就是帮助众生，普度众生，利他就是这个目标。但是呢，利他的前提的条件，首先就要利己，利己就是首先把我自己的问题解决了，我自己的问题解决了以后，我才能够解决别人的问题。所以 首先我自己要走上解脱道，才能够我让更多的人走解脱道。
From the Buddha's point of view, this more noble goal of or more noble value of human existence is benefiting others or benefiting other beings. However, in order to be able to fulfill this goal, it's necessary that we are first able to benefit ourselves. So it's for this reason that we need to achieve enlightenment, achieve Buddhahood, and that's why we set ourselves on the path of liberation.
首先解决自己的问题，然后再解决别人的问题，这个就是一个很现实的，很符合实际的一个做法。
This approach whereby we first address our own problems and then go about addressing the problems of others is an extremely practical, sensible, pragmatic approach.
就像我们坐飞机，在飞机的机舱里面试压的时候呢，首先把这个氧气罩自己要戴上，戴上了以后呢，再帮别人戴这个氧气罩。
It's just like being in an airplane cabin when there's a lack of oxygen. First, we put on our own mask before assisting another person.
如果自己不戴上这个氧气罩，自己呼吸不了了，最后就是自己的问题解决不了，别人的问题更加的解决不了。If
we have not helped ourselves in this situation and we aren't able to breathe, then we'll be in an extremely bad position to be of use to other people.
同样的就是佛教告诉我们，首先把自己的生老病死的问题解决，解决了以后呢，我们才有能力去帮助别人。And
it's exactly by the same logic that the Buddhist tradition teaches us to first solve our own problem of psychic existence before we go on to attempting to solve the problems of other living beings.
所以我们就是 在这个生存下来了以后，当我们的生存的问题解决了以后呢，我们一定要有一些这样子的一些目标。So
once we have addressed our basic needs of survival, it's essential that we have some additional higher goals like these.
如果没有，当我们的生存问题解决以后，没有这样子的这个目标的话，那么第一个我们不能解脱。 第二个，在现实生活当中，我们也真的是感觉不到真正的幸福的。If
after we've satisfied our own basic needs for survival, we don't have these additional goals, then not only will
就是如果没有这样子的生存的目标的话，那么 我们第一个，我们不能解脱；第二个，在生活当中也感受不到幸福。Yes,
if we don't have these additional goals, then not only will we not be able to achieve liberation, we won't be able to achieve a sense of real happiness.
有一位西方的哲学家，他说一句话，说得非常的好，跟释迦牟尼佛说的完全是一样的。
There's a Western philosopher who said something that is put it very well, and the way that he put it was very similar to the way the Buddha has expressed things.
说什么呢？就是当我们的欲望没有得到满足的时候呢，因为还没有得到欲望的满足，所以非常非常的痛苦啊。然后呢？ 得到了满足的时候呢，立即就变成了非常的无聊。
And the way that he put it was that, well, until we have satisfied our desires, or before we have satisfied our desires, we feel great pain and discomfort. However, as soon as we are able to satisfy our desires, we find ourselves feeling immediately very bored.
这句话佛教里面呢，就是讲过成千上万次了。This
is statement or an idea that Buddhism has reiterated many, many times.
这个是为什么呢？就是因为我们的这个感官啊，因为我们用这个感官去享受心福，其实是没有办法能够享受到真正的这个心福，所以佛要求我们把我们的感官提升，提升到一定的时候，再去享受另外一种心福。
The reason being that the Buddha taught that it's impossible for us to achieve happiness through the perceptions of our sense organs. For this reason, it's necessary to enhance our sensorial perception so that we are able to perceive or experience a higher kind of happiness.
好，我们以上这样的这些理由是告诉我们应该寻找一个生存的目标，就是这样子。我们现在的所作所为，一切都是为了生存。那么生存也应该有一个另外一个目标。那么这个就是我们前面讲的，就是这全面的前面我们讲的这些各种各样的理由。
So everything that we have talked about up until this point is really to convince ourselves that we need to have a goal that our existence is oriented towards.
那么生存的目标当然有很多很多种，什么样的东西我们都可以作为生存的目标，都可以的。但是呢，那这些当中最永久的、最彻底的、最完美的，就是解脱，把我们的这个烦恼所有的烦恼都断掉，那么这样子的境界是最完美的追求的境界。
Of course, there are all kinds of possible goals that we could orient our existences to. However, the most enduring, the most lasting, the most complete and the most perfect is liberation and the end to all our suffering.
那么这个境界是什么呢？就是佛的境界。我们人类的这个境界上升到这个至高无上的时候呢，就叫做 佛的境界，其实这个我们的追求，最后应该是佛的境界。And
this state is in fact the state of Buddhahood. It should be to this state or the enhancement, the improvement, the bettering of our human state. Until we reach this state, that we should orient our efforts, and it's this state which is the state of a Buddha.
这个道理知道了以后呢，我们就下决心，我一定要解脱，我一定要把我自己的生老病死的问题解决。解决完了以后呢，我一定要解决其他更多的人的生老病死的这个问题，我一定要解决更多人的生老病死问题。这个就是我的生存的目标，这样子下决心，这叫做处理心。
So knowing this, we resolve to liberate ourselves, to enter the path of liberation, and not only to solve the problems of our psychic existence, and not only of ourselves, but also those of other living beings. And it is this resolution that that is renunciation.
好，最后我们。 简单的说，什么叫做处理心呢？处理心就是简单的说，就是我不应该 就是为了这个感官的刺激而生存啊，就是为了通过感官的刺激所获得的这一点点的这个幸福而这个生存。那我应该超越这个，我应该追求，应该追求更高的这个境界啊。那么，所以呢，我一定要解脱，我一定要走上解脱的道路啊，就是这种决心啊。当我们有了坚定不移的这种决心的时候呢，那么我们已经有了非常标准的处理心。
So putting it simply, it is renunciation is the rejection of a view or an idea of life that is underpinned by simply living for the pleasure and stimulation of our senses. It is the resolution, the determination to go beyond this, to achieve liberation. And when we have really cast this resolution in a firm and unwavering, unfaltering way, then we can consider ourselves to have generated a proper standard of renunciation.
好，那么接下来我们啊，就简单的说，这个我们，那我们这个没有这个处理心的话，我们怎么样让我们自己升起这个处理心呢？
So now we're going to go on and talk a little bit about what we can do to generate renunciation if we don't currently have it.
那么修处理心的非常具体的方法就叫做思加心。
A really concrete approach or a really concrete method for generating renunciation is reflecting on the four thoughts that turn the mind.
希望大家修这个思加心啊，思加心第一个是人生难得，第二就是死亡无常，第三就是轮回的痛苦，第四因果不续，就要去思考这四个问题。
I hope that everybody really seriously contemplates these four thoughts that are also referred to as the four common preliminaries. The first of these thoughts is the appreciation for the preciousness of human rebirth. The second is impermanence and mortality. The third is karma and its consequences. And the fourth is the shortcomings of samsara.
好，然后这个四个这个思维或者这四个修心的方法呢，我们可以网上啊，可以网上可以找这个资料，有很多书啊，关于这个思加心方面的很多书，然后也有音频视频啊，大家都可以这个看啊，通过网络学习啊，还有光盘啊，这个关于思加心无加心方面的光盘我们可以听完了以后呢啊，随时都可以修，我们明天后天会传一下这个传承啊，口传，这样子以后呢大家随时都可以修。
These four contemplations, the four common preliminaries, there's much material available online, there are books available, DVDs, instructional videos,and all kinds of reference material that people can access in order to learn more about them. And in the coming days, we'll also give a transmission for the preliminary practices.
好，这样子的话呢，我们今天的这个课程的内容呢，归纳的话，就是说，如果要学佛，那正确的道路是什么呢？正确的道路首先要修处理心。有了处理心以后呢，我们已经走上了解脱的道，这个就是正确无误的道啊。简单的说就是这样子。
So in a nutshell, tonight's teaching has been about entering and choosing a proper path for Buddhist practice, and that proper path being the path of liberation. Once we have generated renunciation properly, then we can be considered to have entered the path of liberation.
好，我们最后大家走回乡啊，回乡呢，意思就是说，我们今天大家讲经说法、听经闻法，这个功德是相当大。那么这个功德是善有善报的，一定会有报啊，果报。那么这个果报我们分享给天下所有的众生啊，天下所有的众生，希望他们暂时能够健康长寿、幸福啊，最终能够获得佛的果位啊，以这样子的心态回向。
So we're now going to dedicate the merit from listening to this evening's teaching. We will receive very good merit from listening to the teaching tonight. So we dedicate this merit to other living beings, all living beings, in the hope that they receive temporary happiness and as well as ultimate happiness through the attainment of Buddhahood.
好，我们大家一起念这个回向词。
So num de yi tam jo zuba nya to ne ni be da na ban she ja je ga na jo wa lon zu ba to bin zo len zo a zo wa sho o ma a ho ban zhe ge zhe ba ma se de ho Om Ahom Banzhengarabhamasadhom Om Ahom Banzhengarabhamasadhom
谢谢大家阿弥陀佛